Okay, well, welcome back to Spectrograph Theory, hosted by Dr. Leditsky, and I am going to be your voice of Dr. Leditsky for the next 45 minutes, give or take. So, where are we at? So, we've talked about the Laplacian matrix, which is D minus A. We said, aha, this matrix is totally awesome, because it has all ones as the eigenvector. And namely, this is the all ones eigenvector for the eigenvalue of 0. All right, and we talked about a few basic facts, and we wanted to build up a few more basic facts, and then we can get to what we want to get to today. Now, let's talk about something that we did for adjacency matrix. We saw for the adjacency matrix, if G is regular, that there was a nice relationship between G and G complement. And namely, we said, well, look, if my eigenvalues were k, lambda 2, up through lambda n, then what I got was I had n minus 1 minus k, comma, minus 1 minus lambda 2, minus 1 minus lambda n. So in other words, most of my eigenvalues were pretty easy to figure out. There was sort of one exceptional case, which was the eigenvector, which corresponded to all ones. Now, this is for the adjacency matrix. Well, what about the Laplacian matrix? Well, the observation to make is that for the Laplacian matrix, if I take the Laplacian matrix of G plus the Laplacian matrix of the complement of G, what will I get? Well, I'm going to get the diagonal will be equal to n minus 1. And that's because every possible edge is represented, and I'm going to have minus 1s in the off diagonal. So this is equal to n times the identity matrix minus j, the all ones matrix. Now, we have to think, how do our eigenvalues translate? Well, for our eigenvalues for the Laplacian matrix, so here's g, my eigenvalues would be 0, comma, mu1, mu2, up through mu n. So for G complement, well, let's think about it. For adjacency, we said there was our special graph which was associated with all ones, and that we translated over. Well, look, the all ones eigenvector for G is still an eigenvector for G complement. In G, it corresponds to 0. And G complement for the Laplacian corresponds to 0. Okay, good, done, easy. Now, everything else has to be perpendicular to the all ones. Well, what does that say? Well, what that really says is I should rearrange this and say, look, the Laplacian matrix of G complement is n times I minus j minus the Laplacian matrix of G. And I'm adjacent to the all ones, so when I multiply by j, I get 0. And so I'm going to get n minus my eigenvalues. So they are n minus mu1, n minus mu2, up through n minus mun. Now, we can check this pretty simply. So we can make, for example, the following observation. If I start with my empty graph, and I should point out, this is hopefully clear, if I look at, on a side note, G union H, where I'm taking disjoint union, and I look at the Laplacian of that, well, it's really a block matrix. Laplacian of G, Laplacian of H on the diagonal, zeros on the off diagonal. So if I'm computing disjoint union of graphs, I only need to do the one component and the other component, and I combine them together. So if G were n copies of K1, well, then the Laplacian has spectrum of 0, 0, 0, 0, all zeros. All right. Well, now, if I look at G complement, which is the complement would be the complete graph, the spectrum would be what? Well, 0, first 0, stays as 0, and the rest of them are n minus. So n, comma, da da da, comma, n. So this is n minus 1. Well, that's what we observed last time. But we can use this to quickly build up a couple of basic graphs. Suppose I want to get complete bipartite graphs. So in other words, I want to find k, m, comma, n. Well, what I can do is I can think of k, m, comma, n as first thing, I'll find k, m union k, n. And the spectrum of that, well, is 0, comma, 0, comma. Then I'm going to have m, and this will be m minus 1 times, and then I'm going to have n, and that will be n minus 1 times. All right, and the reason there are two zeros is I have two components, one for each of these cliques. And now, take the complement. So k, m, comma, n is the complement of the union of these two cliques. Now this has m plus n vertices. So this 0 stays 0, because remember, the first 0 stays at 0. The second 0 is going to become m plus n, because it's m plus n minus 0. Now the m's, well, I'm going to get m plus n minus m. So I'm going to get n, and I'm going to get this m minus 1 times. I'm going to get n plus n minus n, which is m, and I'm going to get this n minus 1 times. All right, so that's the spectrum of complete bipartite graphs for the Laplacian. Now, you'll notice here there was a philosophy in play. It said, look, let me find the disjoint union and take the complement. Well, what does that say? It says that if I wanted to do joins, joins are now very nice. So in particular, what I can do is to make the observation. If I want to look at the join of G and H, that is equal to G complement union H complement complement. And then I say, okay, well, what's going on? Well, let's follow the logic here. So G has spectrum initially 0, mu 1, mu 2. Well, actually, I'm going to make it mu 2 because I'm going to have 0 be my first one, mu 3, up to mu sub n. So that's my spectrum for G. And now my spectrum for H, well, that is going to be 0. And working my way to the alphabet, let's go up to theta. I don't think that's actually the next letter in the alphabet, but that's okay. No one has to know. Theta sub m. So first off, find the complements. So G complement union H complement, the spectrum will be what? Well, I'm going to get a 0, and I'm going to get another 0, and then I'm going to get n minus mu 2 up through n minus mu n. Then here I'm going to get m minus theta 1 up to m minus theta 2. So this right here is for G complement union H complement. In other words, take the complement of H, take the complement of G separately, combine them together. And, okay, now what's left? Well, we take the complement, okay? So what are we going to have? Well, we're going to have a lot. Remember, now we have m plus n vertices, so I'm going to take m plus n minus all of this. So, but except for that one, 0. And therefore, the spectrum is going to become the following. It's going to become 0. That 0 stays 0. That was the all ones, 0. Then this 0 becomes m plus n. Now, here, I'm going to take m plus n minus this. The n's will cancel, and that minus becomes plus. So it's m plus mu 2 up through m plus mu n. And then similarly, m plus n minus that becomes n plus theta 1 up to n plus theta, this was supposed to be an m here. Theta sub m. Okay, so joins, easy. Another thing that's easy is Cartesian product. So remember, in the Cartesian product, G Cartesian product H, when we had for the adjacency matrix, we said, look, just do all possible sums, where lambda is an eigenvalue in the adjacency matrix for G, and mu was an eigenvalue for the adjacency matrix for H. All right. Now that's for the adjacency matrix. For the Laplacian matrix, what do? And the answer is, we take all possible sums. Lambda is in the spectrum of the Laplacian matrix of G, mu is in the spectrum of the Laplacian matrix for H. In other words, Cartesian products are still nice. It's one of the reasons we love Cartesian products. Cartesian products are just awesome. They might say, cool, well, how about strong products or tensor products? And the answer is, it doesn't work. The problem is that when you do strong products or Cartesian products, when you do the big matrix, you start getting all these diagonal entries in weird places, and so it doesn't translate very nicely. So unfortunately, there's no nice expression for those matrices. Okay. But now, we can find the eigenvalues for various matrices associated with the Laplacian matrix. But is there that one killer app? You know, is there some feature about the Laplacian matrix that people say, wow, that's so cool, I'm going to go out and just buy a lot of Laplacian matrix stocks? And the answer is yes. So that's our goal, our main goal for this session. And that is the following. Kirchhoff's matrix tree theorem. Now, to talk about the matrix tree theorem, what is it about? It's about a matrix. And here, the matrix is the Laplacian matrix. So this is why the Laplacian matrix is totally awesome, because we have this cool theorem. Now, tree, well, what is that talking about? Here, tree is talking about a spanning tree. Okay, so we haven't actually talked much about trees. We've touched on examples of trees. For example, a star is a tree and a path is a tree. And it's going to be important to our conversation that we at least understand what we mean by tree, what we mean by a spanning tree. So there's a couple ways to define a tree. So let's come to the side and talk about trees. So a tree is a graph on n vertices which has no cycle. So in other words, I don't loop up. And the idea of calling the graph a tree is you can think of how a tree grows, is it can branch out, but the branches don't come back together unless you're doing some really weird topiary stuff to that poor tree. But anyways, so the idea is that trees branch out, but they don't come back and join up together. Now, there's a couple of facts that are true. First off, you can also say that there's a couple of equivalent things. Trees are graphs on n vertices, which has no cycle. Oh, yes, I should have added, and is connected. I should have said that. So if it's not connected and you don't have a cycle, what you have is a collection of trees. And of course, in graph theory, we have a good name for that, as we have a good name for everything in graph theory. A bunch of trees is a forest. Okay, so trees are graphs on n vertices, which have no cycle and n minus one edges. In other words, there's sort of a threshold. If you have n vertices and n edges, then your average degree is just enough that you're like, and that pushes you so that you have to have a cycle somewhere. And usually it means that your cycle isn't a component. And you can also say, well, in fact, you could give a whole lecture on trees, and I fear that I'm quickly becoming a whole lecture on trees, but trees are graphs on n vertices. Well, what have we done? Well, no cycle connected, no cycle n minus 1 edges, so we might as well do the last combination, which has n minus 1 edges and is connected. Okay. All right. So in other words, for trees, pick 2 out of 3. Cycle, no cycle, n minus 1 edges, connected. All right. Now, what do we care about for trees? Well, there's a few things. First off, you can model a lot of things on trees, like branching processes are done in terms of trees. And if you do programming, you often see a lot of decision trees. What we often care about is what are called leaves. So a leaf, this is a vertex of degree 1. So in other words, if you think about what a tree is and you say, well, what's a leaf? It's the very end of the tree. So for instance, you have a lot of leaves in a graph. And one fact, which we will need, each tree has at least 2 leaves. Now, most trees have more, but each tree has at least 2. And that's as good as we can say, because, for example, the path is a tree, and there's exactly 2 leaves on the path. Okay, so roughly speaking, that is a tree. Now, a spanning tree. Okay, what is a spanning tree? Well, that's an idea that we really have not touched on very well, and hopefully we'll draw lots of pictures in the actual day. But what I'm looking for is to span really says the following. I want to cover all vertices of the graph. So in particular, so I'm looking for a subset of the edges such that I, one, form a tree with those edges, and two, I incident to all vertices. All right, so perhaps it would be good to give some examples. So let's start with a very small basic graph. And so here's our very small basic graph. And this is our same graph from last time. So our C4 with a chord, or if you like, our diamond, shining bright like a diamond. How many spanning trees are there? Well, okay. Let's go ahead and see how many we can make. So we'll start. There's one. In other words, I'm just going to take that. And of course, I could have just gone from the other side. And so I have 2 copies of K13. Now, you might say, well, wait a second. Those are the same tree. But when we talk about spanning trees, we're really thinking about these as labeled graphs. And so these are labeled trees. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and 1, 2, 3, 4. So let me be more explicit. 2 is connected now to 1, 3, and 4. 3 is connected to 1, 2, and 4, and that defines all the edges. So I can take everything adjacent to 2, take everything adjacent to 3. Now, what else do we have? Well, we have 1 going down to 2, which then goes down to 4, which goes back up to 3. All right, we can do that. We can also have 1 going to 3, going to 4, going to 2. We also can, of course, have 2 going to 1, going to 3, going to 4. And we can also have the 3 going to 1, going to 2, going to 4. Okay, so in particular, I'm taking the outside of my graph, and then I am going to think of it as a 4-cycle, and I delete every possible edge. And okay, did we get them all? And the answer is no. Okay, so which ones did we miss? Well, we missed 1, goes to 3, goes to 2, goes to 4, and also 1 goes to 2, goes to 3, goes to 4. Okay, so that brings us up to 8, and I think 8 is the right answer. We'll check in just a minute. I think that gets them all. We'll double check. So, okay, so now we have this large number of spanning trees. So what is Kirchhoff's matrix tree theorem? Well, the goal is I want to use the Laplacian to figure out how many spanning trees there are. That's the goal of Kirchhoff's matrix tree theorem. So let's make the statement. And here is the statement. So let Lii be the Laplacian matrix of G with the ith row and ith column deleted. Then the determinant of Lii is equal to the number of spanning trees. So in particular, I can find it through the Laplacian. But here's the really cool thing. So suppose my matrix has eigenvalues lambda 1 is 0, because lambda 1 is always 0, and lambda 2 up through lambda n. Then what I can say is that this determinant is found by taking 1 over n times lambda 2 up through lambda n. And okay, so that is the number of spanning trees. Now, this last step, going from the determinant of Lii is 1 over n times the product of the non-zero eigenvalues, that is linear algebra. I will not do that, but I will do this first part. So time for us to do a check. Okay, so what do I mean by a check? Remember this matrix, or rather this graph? Let's go ahead and figure out what happens here. So I'm going to take my graph. Let me redraw it. And I'll label it as I just did on the previous page, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And now I'm going to write my matrix. So L here, I'm going to have plus 2. That's my degree. Then minus 1, minus 1, 0. Minus 1, minus 1, 0. Then I'm going to have 3, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1. So, okay, first row, 2, minus 1, minus 1, 0. Second row, minus 1, 3, minus 1, minus 1. Third row, minus 1, minus 1, 3, minus 1. And the fourth row, 0, minus 1, minus 1, 2. So that's our matrix. And now we say, okay, let's take the determinant when we cross out the ith row and ith column. Well, which row and which column do we cross out? And the answer is whichever one pleases us. So, for instance, I could cross out the first row and the first column. And then I have a 3 by 3 matrix. 3, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, 3, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, 2. Now you might worry, do I know this is positive? And you can actually show that if your graph is connected, it will be positive. But we will not get into that. Okay, so 3 by 3 is not bad. So this will be 3 times 3 times 2, which is 9 times 2, that's 18. Minus 1 times minus 1 times minus 1 is minus 1. Minus 1 times minus 1 times minus 1 is minus 1. And I'm going to have negative going up. Negative 1 times 3 times negative 1, that's minus 3. Negative 1 times negative 1 times 3, that's minus 3. And I'm going to have 2 times negative 1 times negative 1, that's minus 2. All right, so I'm going to have 18, and And if I add all these up, 1, 1, 3, 3, 2, that's 10. 18 minus 10 is 8. Aha! 8. Remember, we found 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So, assuming the theorem is true, we were successful. We found them all. Now, just to convince ourselves that it doesn't matter what we cross out, I'm going to now repeat this, but now cross out a different row and different column. So now it would be the determinant of a different matrix. So it would be 2, minus 1, 0, and then I would have minus 1, 3, minus 1, and then I would have 0, minus 1, 2. All right, now that's obviously a different matrix, and so maybe it's a little bit surprising that we're going to end up with the same number. So take the determinant, 2 times 3 times 2, 12. Minus 1 times minus 1 times 0, 0. All right, 0 times minus 1 times minus 1, 0. So I get 12 plus 0 plus 0. Then I'm going to subtract. 0 times 3 times 0 is 0. And minus 1 times minus 1 times 2 is 2, so subtract 2. And 2 times minus 1 times minus 1 is another 2. 12 plus 0 plus 0 minus 0 minus 2 minus 2 is again 8. 8. Cool. All right. Now we have our statement of our theorem. We've seen at least in one case that it's true. And in the next, however much time it takes, we are going to prove it in all the other cases. So in other words, this is going to be something which is true for all graphs. All right. So here we go. How are we going to prove this? Well, we're going to go back and recall one thing we said last time, which is the following. We said that C here is the oriented incidence matrix. All right, so we've seen this matrix before. So I have the rows are indexed by U, or the vertices, I should say. The columns are indexed by E, the edges. And the entries are either plus, minus 1, if there's an incidence. And remember, we didn't really care whether it was plus 1 or minus 1. We care to a very small degree today. It will come up, but in the end, it doesn't matter which orientation you use, and 0 otherwise. And now, we also recall that L was equal to C times C transposed. Now, here's the thing. What would happen if I wanted to compute L, I? Well, that is equal to what I will call CI, CI transpose, where CI is C with the ith row deleted. Okay. So far, so good. Everything checks out. So we want to take the determinant of LII. And to do that, how are we going to figure that out? Well, we think about what's happening. So we have that LII, which is this small square matrix, is equal to this sort of oblongish matrix times a really tall matrix. And it would be nice if somehow we could figure out how can I compute the determinant of this small matrix by this really big matrix, which seems somewhat counterintuitive, but there's a nice fact. So here, this is CI, CI transpose. So here's our nice fact. Suppose I have the following, and let me side note, this is called Cauchy-Binet, so if you want to look this up. This is linear algebra. I'm not going to prove this. You can find this. This is actually in the book, Proofs from the Book. So it must have a really beautiful proof. After all, it's in the book. But what I'm going to just do is state it. So suppose B is an n by n matrix, and it's equal to P, which is n by, I'll just say Q, times R, which is Q by N. So in other words, and I'm in the situation that I'm in here. Then the determinant of B is equal to the sum over all S, which is a subset of Q, where the size of S equals N. And I apologize, my notation there is very bad. So in case you haven't seen this notation before, when I say bracket Q, that is 1 up to Q. So what I'm looking here is I'm trying to say I have these many, many, many columns. And I want to just take N of those columns at any given time. So think about S as an index set. So then what I'm going to do is I'm going to have P, where I'm going to keep all of my rows, and then I'm going to keep only the columns of S. And I'm going to multiply by Q, where I'm going to keep, forget doing determinant here. The determinant of that times, all right, hold on, I apologize. I'm going to have to look in my book. Okay, I'm probably going to make a grisly mistake, but that's okay. Times the determinant of what? Well, times the determinant of R, where now I keep S and then N. Okay, there we go. Yeah, that's right. That's right. So what should you be thinking here? What you should be thinking is, in terms of the picture, I'm doing the following, is I'm taking some block here so that it has the same dimension. So always keeping the same rows, and I'm picking out n columns. They don't have to be contiguous. In other words, you could spread it out. And then over on this matrix, I'm taking the exact same block. And now it's like I was multiplying just those two together and taking the determinant. Now remember that the determinant of a product is the product of determinants. Well, that's one way I could have chosen n blocks, and now I'm going to do it over all possible ways I could have chosen those blocks. I'm going to add it up. Okay. Now, you're probably thinking, my gosh, this looks really, really bad. But, in fact, once we have this theorem, the rest of it will come out pretty quick and not so painful. All right. So here is where we're going to go. We're going to compute the determinant of LII. And so what is the determinant of LII? According to the formula, this is going to be the sum over all S, which is a subset of, and now here's the key. Remember what we're doing here. LII is this incidence matrix. And in the incidence matrix, the rows are indexed by E. So I can say, look, I'm going to take over all S subset of the edges. So that's where I'm doing that. And now, one other thing is, how many edges are we going to take? Well, I'm going to take the right dimension. Now, originally, if I think of my matrix L as having n by n, what I've done is when I take LII, I've subtracted a row and I've subtracted a column. So now my dimension is 1 less, n minus 1. Okay, so I'm taking all subsets of n minus 1 edges. Now at this point, you'll hopefully remember, wait a second, he's used the word n minus 1 edges somewhere earlier today, and that's good. There's a tree connection already forming. And then what we're going to do is we're going to take the determinant of this matrix Ci, where I'm going to take all the rows and then just those edges. I'm going to multiply that by the determinant of Ci transpose, where I take all those edges and the corresponding all the vertices. All right. Now, one thing to note is the determinant of a matrix and the determinant of its transpose are the same. So these are actually equal to each other. So this is equal to the sum over all S, subset of the edges, size of S equals n minus 1, times the determinant of this Ci, where I have all my vertices. Well, technically I should, this is really bad notation. Well, okay. Just, I now, as I write this down, realize that I have bad notation, and Dr. Leditsky will come back and save me. So let's note that, for the record, since I will not have time to re-record up to this point, this should really not be n. This should really be all my vertices, of course, except vertex I. So I'm just going to fix my mistake here and just hang my head down in shame. Oh, Steve, how could you make such a mistake? That's okay. That's okay. All right. And as I said, that was being squared. All right. Well, so what's the point? Well, here's the claim. I'm picking off n minus 1 edges. And I know that I have an observation. So a tree has n minus 1 edges. And so what I'm looking over is I'm looking over all possible subsets of n minus 1 edges. And so I'm done if I can show the following. So if, that's a big if, this is equal to 0 when not a tree, and 1 if a tree, then this would have to be equal to the number of spanning trees. And what's the logic? Well, the logic is the following. It says, look, I'm testing every set of possible of n minus 1 possible edges. And so if I add 1 for every time I get a spanning tree, then the total is the number of spanning trees. OK, so that's actually not bad logic at all. All right, now here's the question. What happens? How can we show it counts the number of spanning trees? Well, so let's do two cases. So I'm thinking about S as being my subset of edges. So case one, S does not form a spanning tree. Okay. So I have a collection of vertices, sorry, I have a collection of edges, and it doesn't form a spanning tree. Well, remember, what do I know about a tree? Well, I know it has n minus 1 vertices, sorry, it has n minus 1 edges. And it's connected. That's enough to form a tree. So given that it's not a tree, and I already know it has n minus 1 edges, I can conclude, well, then it must be that the graph is not connected, so that the resulting set of edges is not connected. Okay, now we're almost done with this case. So we have this spanning tree. We know that the edges are not connected. If the edges are not connected, then I say there's more than one component. So let C be a component. And since I have more than one, I can make a choice. And Remember, we deleted vertex I, so somehow I should never come into play. So let C be a component without I. So I know there's at least one component without I. And let the corresponding vertices be V1 up through V sub T. So in other words, those are my components of C. And now, here's my claim. If I add all the rows which correspond to V1 up through VT in, what am I doing? The CI where I've taken everything but V minus I and I have S. Well, what's true? Well, what's true here is when I look at this, I'm adding all the rows. Any edge, here's my rows I'm going to add. Any edge in this incidence matrix, if I have a 1 or a minus 1, I also have to have a minus 1. Why? Well, look, I cannot split between the two because then I'm saying, look, that's not my full list of vertices which are connected. So I have to have 1 and minus 1 down below. And I have to have both. Why? Well, if I don't have both, then either 1's upstairs or I only had one entry in that column which was non-zero, but that would mean it came from I. And look, I tossed out I. And therefore, if I have a non-zero entry in this row that I'm adding, I have both non-zero entries. Or it's possible I have all zeros. But when I add those rows together, I see they add up to all zeros. That tells me that this matrix has to be singular because there's a non-trivial combination of the rows gives me the zero vector. Well, if the matrix is singular, then that's telling me that the determinant has to be zero. All right, so if I'm not a tree, then in my count, I'm not getting zero combined into my count. Okay, so let's check back in on what we needed to show. We needed to show, look, if this is not a tree, if these set of edges don't form a tree, I'm not going to get zero. So we're halfway done. The other half says, look, if I am a tree, I'm going to get 1. Okay, well, so now we're up to case 2. So case 2. S does form a spanning tree. So I've taken these n minus 1 edges, and I formed a spanning tree. Now, remember, there's an important fact. All trees have at least 2 leaves. Now, I want to use that fact here. How do I use that? Well, I say pick a leaf, and because I have 2 leaves, I know I'm not going to pick a leaf which is vertex I. And now what I'm going to do is I say, okay, so now I've picked my leaf, and I'm going to do the following. I note that that leaf only is connected to one edge, and so suppose that's vertex is V and edge is E. I'm going to re-index, which is another way to say I'm just going to permute. And I'm going to put V down at the bottom, and I'm going to put E out at the end. And so I have this type of relationship. Now, V and E are connected, which means that this last entry is plus minus 1. down there. Now, E could have another plus minus one entry somewhere, but for me, I don't care. So I'll just put there's something there. I don't know what it is. Probably either all zeros or all zeros with a one or a minus one somewhere. Now, let's think about this part here. So I'm talking about the last row. I know V is incident to E. Can V be incident to any other edge in my set? And the answer is no. Why not? Well, because a leaf can only be incident to one edge. So that tells me that this part is all zero. Okay. So that's nice. We've permuted it. But where do we go from here? And the answer is we repeat. Now take out V from your graph. So when you take a tree with a leaf and you take off a leaf, you still have a tree. So we take V off, we still have a tree. And what can we do? We have another vertex, V twiddle, another edge, E twiddle, and we again permute. This is plus minus one, this is something, and this is zero. Well, we keep going. And now, by a permutation, in other words, we do a relabeling, what we're going to get is the following. On the diagonal, we get plus minus 1. Below the diagonal, we get 0. Above the diagonal, we have stuff. And therefore, what can we conclude? Well, it's an upper triangular matrix. And so when we take the determinant of this upper triangular matrix, so that's the determinant of V minus I comma S squared, well, we multiply. So that's the determinant of plus minus 1. The determinant becomes either plus or minus 1 squared, which is 1. Okay, so where are we at? Well, this says, look, if you do form a tree, then your contribution is 1. But remember, what did we want? We wanted to show that if we formed a tree, our contribution was 1. Okay, QED. QED, we're done. Now, all right, let's do one final note. So there's a question. How many labeled trees are there on n vertices? So I have n vertices. I want to say how many trees are there out there. So I again, permuting the labeling, that's considered a different tree. All right. Well, there's another way to answer this. Alternative approach is to say the following. If I want to count how many labeled trees there are on n vertices, I can count the spanning trees. On Kn. So that if I know how many spanning trees are on Kn, each spanning tree on Kn is a labeled tree. Conversely, each labeled tree is a spanning tree on Kn. Because remember, what is Kn? Kn is a graph on n vertices, so 1, 2, 3, da da da, up to n, and every edge is connected to every other possible edge. So if you give me a labeled tree, that's a spanning tree. Every spanning tree is a labeled tree. So it's the same count. So the answer, you say, aha, well, it's the determinant of, you take the Laplacian matrix, delete any entry. Of course, there's symmetry. Now the Laplacian matrix for for Kn, you have n minus 1 on the diagonals, and you have minus 1s on the off diagonals. And so the determinant, well, it's going to be determinant of the matrix of n minus 1 on the diagonals, minus 1 on the off diagonals, but where this is a n minus 1 by n minus 1 matrix. But we can do a little bit better than that, because we also recall so that the number of spanning trees is equal to the ratio, well, I should say 1 over n, and n is the number of vertices, the product lambda 2 up through lambda n. And so, where does that give us? Well, what are the eigenvalues? The eigenvalues of kn, and we've computed these before, are 0 and n. So there's, in particular, there's multiplicity n minus 1 of those. And so lambda 2, lambda 3, so forth and so on up to lambda n is all n. So this is 1 over n times n times n times n. And this is multiplied together, n minus 1 times. So when I put this all together, I get the answer. This is n to the power n minus 2. Now that's a beautiful, beautiful answer. And if you're a mathematician, you might say, wow, cool, and be tempted to say, is there a nice way to prove that? And the answer is yes. What we just did is a nice way to prove that. But you might say, is there another nice way to prove that? And the answer is, of course, yes, there are. In fact, there are many nice ways to prove this. For instance, you can read about proofer codes. And you might say, proofer codes, that sounds like perfect for trying to prove something. But no, proofer was a mathematician, another mathematician who had a really good name. And so, that's another story. And that will finish it up for today. And thus ends the visit of Dr. Leditsky. And we were glad that he could be there. All right. Thank you, and see you next week.